Good morning, Second Service. We have been declaring this morning that Jesus is our champion. We look to continue to declare every mountain and every giant and every Red Sea in our life, our champion is coming and he's making a way. I've tried so hard to see it. Took me so long to believe it. That you choose someone like me to carry your victory. Perfection could never earn it. You give what we don't deserve, and you take the broken things, raise them to glory. With every voice lifted up, you are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you won, I am who you say I am. Hey, you crown me with confidence. I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated with the one who has conquered all, it all, it all, it all, it all. Now I can finally see it. You're teaching me how to receive it. So let all the striving cease. This is my victory. Has given me when I open up, miracles start doing it, signs and wonders. I have the authority. Jesus has given it to me.
Jesus has.
Miracles start breaking.
champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated.
Every battle.
Every battle you won.
Yes, and I am.
And I am who you say I am.
Cause he crowned me.
Crown me with confidence.
Yes, I am seated.
In the heavens.
And he's always been undefeated. By the power.
By the power of your name, I am seated. Heavenly place undefeated with the one who has conquered it all.
Celebrate him, celebrate him.
Come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Ephesians 4:22-24 says to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in the true righteousness and holiness. But how do you do that? Romans 5:8-11 says, but God shows his love for us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God? For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, now how much more are we reconciled shall we be saved by his life? More than that, also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. The cross beckons us. Come, receive hope, receive freedom. Receive the freedom that was purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood. To wait, Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are Jesus Christ, who come to the altar. Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen.
We thank you for the glory that's being revealed right now. Father, we just declare in this place that the relationship with you is more important than anything else in the world. God, we just thank you for your glory. We thank you for your glory. We thank you for your glory. Right now in this place, there is a need for hearts of worship. There's a breakthrough that can happen when we worship him. He said, I'm looking throughout the earth, finding true worship so I can rest on you. God, rest on us. Rest on us in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. How he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about, I came to the altar one day, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet. Can you get excited about it? On solid ground. When I think about the Lord, let's get excited. When I think about the Lord, how he saved me,
how he saved
and he raised me up from that grave.
He raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost,
and he healed every heart.
How he healed
bring in the name of Jesus.
The
when I think
Lord,
about it,
when I think about
I should have been
the Lord
in my grave.
How he picked me up, turned me around, how he placed my fear. Solid ground.
It makes me
wanna shout.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, your word
of all the glory, and all the honor.
And all the praise.
It makes me wanna shout. It makes me wanna shout.
That he lives.
I can tell the story. How he delivered me.
Lord, your word. Of all of the glory,
all the glory,
and all of
the honor,
and all the praise.
It makes me want to shout it.
It makes me want to shout.
Thank you, Jesus. Glory to your name.
Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory, and all of the honor,
and
all the praise.
It makes me want to shout.
It makes me want to shout.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus,
oh,
Lord.
worthy of all the glory and all the honor, all the praise. It makes me want to shout. Spirit of the Lord say, miracles, signs, and wonders is happening in this place. We're not just trying to fill a building. I want His glory. Yeah, 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 yeah. Makes me want to for His presence. Let's go behind the glory cloud. Let's go. Worthy to be praised.
When I ran out of road, I met a man I didn't know.
choice but to believe. My doubts are burning, yeah, like ashes in the wind. Somebody say goodbye, goodbye, goodbye.
So long to my old friend.
The burden and bitterness.
Burden and bitterness.
Oh, you can just keep it moving, baby. Oh, no, you ain't welcome here. Every dry place of addiction is broken. Every isolated spirit is broken. Every spirit of depression is broken. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave, you say. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Get up.
Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave.
Get up. Come on. Get up, get up, get up. Get up, get up, get up.
Please.
welcome you, our guests and friends. We are thankful that God has resurrected us. Turn to your neighbor, give him a high five and say, I thank God, I thank God.
Second service. Good to be with you this morning. Wasn't that worship incredible? Yes, so good. My name is Pastor Aaron. I'm very happy to be with you this morning. And I want to welcome any of our first-time guests who may be here first time this morning, watching online. We are happy that you are with us. Can we give our first-time guests a round of applause? We are really excited that you're here. If it is your first time, we'd love to connect with you. We'd love to meet you, know who you are. You could do that by filling out a connection card. You could meet us after service. There'll be people up here praying for people. They would love to just introduce themselves to you, show you around, meet people. That's what we really want to do. Or you could scan this QR code. That's the fastest way for us to get back to you later this week, where you can inquire about any of our ministries or give us prayer requests and things like that, but just ways for us to be connected. We like lots of ways to be connected. We don't want you to just be the face in the crowd. We believe in the power of the church, what God is doing, how he's moving, and as we as a church unite, fellowship together, pursue the presence and the word of God together, this makes our life infinitely better, including moving in the purposes he has for us. Are you with me, church? It's good news. So be connected. Build relationship. Most important announcement, there is a black Hyundai, a Sonata in the car that is running. A black car running. Hyundai Sonata. License plate RVO408. That wouldn't work on me. I do not know my license plate number off the top of my head. What's the VIN? Black Hyundai Sonata is running. Bueller. Black Hyundai Sonata running. You're going to want to check that out. If you are new here and you want to check this out, or you've been coming for a little bit, on Sunday, May 5th, we are having Starting Point. Starting Point is a good place for you to come together and hear our own pastor tell our story, hear from some of our staff and our team, just get to know who we are, what we believe, where we come from, and where we're going. It sounds like a Cotton Eye Joe song. But this is for you to get connected and maybe figure out what your next steps are, if you're ready to become a member or not. But starting point is where you want to find yourself if you're ready to take the next step and figure out what that looks like. So you can sign up for that online or at the Connection Center, but we'd love to have you there. We also have been promoting our Flourish Conference. You may have heard Beth come up last week for one of our last hurrah pushes to get people to sign up. Registration will be closing soon. Great conference for our ladies to get together. It's a lot like our Band of Brothers conference for our men. So we're also looking for volunteers. Like the ladies support us for Bob, we are looking for fellas to step up and volunteer during this conference if there's any way you could be a part of that. So again, for registration or volunteering, go to the Connection Center, let us know what you can do. And just a reminder that they do have a different pricing if you're not able to attend during the day and only attend the weekend, the Saturday and the night evening sessions. They have a price for that as well. And then we want to thank everyone for the grab-and-go meals that we've had and the marketplace that we had set up out there, where all of our funds are going to promote 100% to our mission trips this summer to Africa and Honduras. We're really excited, and you guys have been doing a great job. Can you just put your hands together for all the giving that's been happening? Very, very generous. It's the heart of the church, and we love that. So helping to get the word of God overseas and get some school started. Over $9,000. That's great. Sunday, April 21st, we're going to keep this going. Kenny Huffnagel is going to be doing his famous barbecue pulled pork sandwich. Yes, my mouth is watering. It's not even here yet. With the smoky baked beans and a dessert. $10. Brent, $10. This too can be yours. Plan accordingly. It's going to be great. And again, 100% of these funds go to getting his family to Honduras, and as well as another connecting flight where he's going to be going to Africa as well. The man's on the move. So we're very excited about that and to help promote what's going on. And this Wednesday night, we have our Public Square Ministry meeting where Isaac Carr has been doing an incredible job leading that ministry. And I spoke to him beforehand, and he wanted me to let you know that we're going to have several representatives for candidates this Wednesday that'll be answering questions and promoting their platforms and things like that, letting you know where they're at. And he wanted to remind you that the biggest thing that they're going to be doing is teaching us, number one, what are we prioritize when it comes to what the Bible says, right? What we're looking for according to Scripture. Where do we stand on biblical issues? And then number two, learning how to research candidates ourselves. So then number three, we can make our own informed decisions when it comes to voting and getting people in place that represent biblical values the right way. That's pretty important, right? Right? We can't complain about the direction things are going if we don't take responsibility and ownership ourselves when it comes to who we elect and what we take seriously. We don't want to just be a Sunday morning Christian. We want to be a 365 Christian. Amen? So that's where we're at. And then lastly, before we do our tithes and offerings, as you get those ready, just wanted to remind you, we are doing baptisms today at the end of third service. Very excited about that. So go grab a quick bite to eat or something and come back. And celebrate with us at the end of third service. We're going to be dunking 50 people today. Isn't that great? So we're very excited about what God is doing, people getting saved, people dedicating their lives to the Lord. We're going to keep that worship going with our tithes and offerings right now. So bow your head with me as we go to the Lord. God, we thank you so much for your incredible provision. God, we love having a generous heart, being connected to you. And I thank you, Father, it's a small reminder that all we have belongs to you, God. This small token that we return to you, I pray that you would bless the giver, God, the sower. Return it back to them. Cover our families, our homes, our jobs, our relationships. God, we want you in everything that we do, Lord. Increase our faith. Increase our connection to you. We love you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen. Pastor Ron. Love you, buddy.
I wanted to highlight a milestone we have coming up here in about 5 weeks. It's actually the Sunday after Mother's Day. That will be the three-year anniversary of the pledges that we made in faith for that building. And I want to direct your attention in the bulletin to see where we're at. I'm excited to announce we're at the 85% mark, which is phenomenal. We're approaching the $6 million mark. And I just want to encourage you all, you know, we began this building progress in faith. And I want us to continue to end it in faith, amen, trusting the Lord and relying on God for supernatural increase, not relying on our own natural paychecks, but really coming before the Lord in faith. There's many ways God has provided over the years and highly unexpected ways, and I just want to encourage us, let's really press in. On that particular Sunday, we're going to really celebrate because that is a milestone. How many of you were with us for the last 3 years on the journey? I know we have a lot. Let me ask it this way. How many of you are brand new? You've been with us, you started coming after that three-year part. In other words, you're 3 years or less, okay? A lot of you. So we'll be sharing a lot of highlights, and of course, we're ramping up to the grand opening the end of July, so we want you to make sure you make plans for that. Also, I had Pastor Andrew with me first service. We have been doing a podcast. There it is. The Ron Johnson Discipleship Podcast. It actually started during COVID. We started sitting in the foyer and doing live Facebook updates on what was going on in our world and providing a biblical perspective. How many know the Bible speaks to all kinds of things and Jesus is Lord over every aspect of life? So that means if we go to the scriptures, we can find God's answers for what's going on, at least give us a godly Christ-centered perspective. So this coming Thursday, the podcasts always air on Thursday morning. This coming Thursday, our 200th podcast, all right? So we're excited about that. And I wanted to tell you this amazing plan that we have for this Thursday as we celebrate, but I haven't really got past the party hats and that kind of stuff, and I was relying on Pastor Andrew. He's as empty as I am right now. But we promise you, this Thursday's 200th podcast will be special. We just don't know how special. But we'll be sending out, actually Matthew McCaig will be sending out some emails to those of you on our email list. We'd like to get your feedback on some stuff that you would like us to address in upcoming podcasts. But that, just make a shameless plug here, this is where we have a chance every week to talk about what's happening in the larger culture from a biblical perspective, all right? And I just want to ask this question. Sometimes we take a lot of heat from people who think the church shouldn't be talking about like things outside of the Bible itself. But let me ask you this question. If the church isn't talking about what's going on from a biblical perspective, who is? Nobody is. And so I would rather be a little bit controversial, if that's such a word, than play it safe and be irrelevant. There's too much happening right now. And we need to be speaking into that. So if you're not listening to our podcast, I encourage you, sign up. It'll get delivered to your email every week and give it a listen as we talk about some very, very important things. I also want us to pray for Israel today. Yes. It's interesting. You know, obviously we know the bigger picture, God's hands on his people. The nation of Israel needs a great awakening, like our nation. It seems like the whole world needs a great awakening. We know that God's called us to pray for Israel, to pray his blessing on them, to pray for the peace of Israel. But it all just seems very fishy to me. I'm just talking out loud here. We had a missile attack and drones that everybody knew were coming. There's no surprise there. We, along with Israel, shot them all out of the sky. And it just seems fishy to me, like there's another agenda. I don't know what that is, but it's not how you normally conduct a full-scale war or anything. So anyway, there's a lot of things we don't know about. My prayer is that God would expose all the corruption. There's a whole bunch of it. And how about this, that there'd actually be accountability? A lot of corruption gets exposed, and it seems like nobody's ever going to jail or being put in front of a firing squad. Anyway, that was my commentary. anyway, that I don't know if that was the Holy Spirit or not, but that was just in my heart. I would just like to see some accountability for a change. And so things like elections are important, but even more important is the Church of Jesus Christ. You know, God always says that if my people called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek his face and turn from our wicked ways, he'll hear from heaven. He'll heal our land. So how many of you know the ball's in the church's lap, not in any politician's lap? So we just really need to be pursuing the Lord in this season. Amen? But why don't you stand to your feet? I want us to pray for the building, and just as we wind down, and then I want us to pray and lean into what's going on in Israel. Father, first of all, we just give you praise. It's been an amazing journey of 3 years, and I just want to thank, Lord, all the people who have been so faithful and so committed and just sought you and then sought to obey you once they heard your voice. So, Lord, bless all of them. Thank you for just a great, generous church family. Thank you, Lord, for the celebration that's coming and not too far down the road. Thank you for this milestone of 3 years. And, Father, we just continue to ask you for supernatural provision as we've stuck our necks out in faith and said, all right, Lord, we got nowhere to go. We need more space. Help us. Lord, you've been more than gracious and more than faithful, and so we give you praise and honor and glory, Lord. But now, Lord, we turn our attention to the nation of Israel. Lord, we ask for peace, and we ask for your blessing, and we ask for your protection. And Lord, we ask that those who have been perpetrating all types of violence would be uprooted, Lord. And we pray for the peace of that city. And most of all, Lord, we pray that even as you're shaking things across the world, that the eyes of the Jewish people would be open as your word promises, and that there would be a great harvest of souls from our Israeli friends. Lord, open their eyes and let them see their need for Jesus. And Lord, again, protect them. They're a miracle surrounded by enemies who overtly have stated that their death and their destruction is their goal. And so, Lord, they're a miracle, and they're a testimony to your hand and to the prophetic witness of Scripture. So, Lord, we just pray for them today. We ask your blessing upon them, and we pray that the United States would continue to be a strong ally and that we would not turn our backs on your people to our own demise. God, give us courage and wisdom. Give our leaders courage and wisdom to do the right thing. We pray this all in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen. 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 You can be seated. This message today is a standalone message. We're getting ready to start at the end of this month a series on biblical manhood and biblical womanhood. And I just want to say this. The bulk of our nation's problems go right back to the fact that our homes in America are incredibly weak these days. Everything goes back to the strength of the family. The family's the first church. The family's the first hospital. The family's the first government. The family's first a lot of things. When the family goes, it all goes down the drain in a hurry. That's why at Living Stones we have labored over the years to make sure our marriages are strong. How many of you know you can get caught in social media and get really discouraged and fearful or tormented even? And I've had to, you know, I want to stay abreast of what's going on, as I'm sure you do. But I also want to make sure I don't get under what's going on, because it's a terrible thing to feel responsible for things that are outside of your control. And I don't know if you've ever felt that way. That's why we're trying to equip you to make sure that locally we're leading well, loving well, that our marriages and families are strong, that the people who are leading in our community are good people and godly people and promote righteousness. We can control all those things, and we should be engaged and focusing on all of that. But the bottom line is, you know, we can't see an awakening across America until we model it right here. So I don't know about you, but we really need to be committed to loving our spouses. We need to be committed to raising godly children. We need to be committed to godly grandparenting and making sure, as some of you are in the grandparenting season, that you're loving your kids and grandkids. And we need to be bold witnesses for Christ right here. Those are things we can control. The rest of it we put in the Lord's hands, and we pray and we witness and we preach the gospel and we trust that God is large and in charge, which the Bible says that he is, so I tend to believe it. Amen? The other thing we do in terms of this series right here, I want to talk to you about the Word and the Spirit, a marriage made in heaven. This happens to be one of our core values, and if you guys are listening to your pastor and you love your pastor, boy, that was a manipulative statement right there, then I know you're all in life groups right now being loved on and cared for, because you know that your pastor cannot possibly sit down with every single one of you every week and get involved in your life and have coffee and all that, even though I would love to, but I can't do that. So You got to have people in your life who know you, who see you, who care for you, who encourage you, who pray for you, who are there when you're going through rough times. And can I get a round of applause from anybody who's received the love and support of a church family through your life group in the last year even in this way? Amazing. We just had our dear sister Lori Alisea go home to be with the Lord, and her life group was her main source of ministry during this time. They visited her in the hospital. They brought food. They prayed. They ministered communion to her when she could no longer come to church because she was weak. That was all the life group ministering to a dear sister of theirs. That's the beauty of this. So I really want to encourage you all, get involved. And what we're doing now in the life groups for the next 4 weeks is talking about a series that I did a while back called Our Tribe. It's a series about our DNA and our culture here at Living Stones. And the reason this is so important is one of the things that we are intentional about at Living Stones is we want to make sure that the atmosphere here is welcoming for hosting the Holy Spirit. Now, have any of you ever had a guest over at your house? And you probably call them up and you say, what is your food that you hate the most, right? And then when they show up, then you serve them that, right? No, that's not how it works. In fact, you say, would you like seconds? You know, you don't do that. You normally, if you're a good host or hostess or whatever the situation might be, you think about who it is that you're having over because you want to make this experience the most enjoyable as possible for your guests. So when we're trying to host every Sunday, we're hosting our guests, the Holy Spirit. How many of you know we don't want to do things or act in ways that make him turn up his nose, like, oh, liver and onions? By the way, if you invite Marin and I over for dinner, that's the only, everything else is good. We'll eat anything else that's not moving, but liver and onions, my mom used to make me eat it when I was a kid. She said it built character in your life. I used to pour tons of ketchup on it just to try that. I'd plug my nose, and I still get chills just thinking about it, all right? So we're not going to serve the Holy Spirit liver and onions, all right? He might like it, but we're going to create an atmosphere where he likes being with us. So in your home, if you want your house to be full of the presence of God, how many know sometimes we got to do a little spring cleaning? There's stuff there that needs to go. Stuff that is offensive to the Lord. In your marriage, you say, I want our marriage to be Christ-centered. Well, there's going to be some junk you guys got to throw away. Because the Holy Spirit's like, I ain't hanging out with you guys. You drive me crazy. Come on, you know what I'm talking about. You ever have those family members? You're like, I don't know if I can handle another moment because these folks are driving me crazy. I had two daughters that were close in age. I won't mention their names. Every morning before they went off to school, are those my shoes? That's your shirt. Those are my pants. I'm like, stop it, stop it, stop it. And then it would be like, And I would lose my temper, and it was just ugly. The Holy Spirit's like, I'm out of here. So we had to learn how to manage that. They're all wonderful now. They love each other. It's incredible. They share their clothing. It's amazing. I had to go to four encounters to get healed myself, but all right, so core values are really important because they create an atmosphere where God can do crazy awesome things. So we covered a couple of these. We talked about daring love. How many have sensed the love of God in this place? And I say daring love because daring love is love that's courageous love. It's love that's also united with truth. It's not just cotton candy love. It's love that's united with truth. And that's courageous love. It takes courage to love in that way. One of our core values is bold faith, faith that believes God for big things. How many of you know without faith it's impossible to please God? So I don't know about you, but let's try believing God for crazy, awesome, supernatural things that only God can do, because that's how you honor him. That's what he likes. If you play it safe, God doesn't like that. And the Holy Spirit's like, I'm not even needed around here. These guys got it all figured out. You never want to be the church that has it all figured out, so the Holy Spirit just goes to people that are more desperate. Let's be desperate for the Holy Spirit, amen? Covenant relationships, relationships that last forever. I tell you guys this all the time, you know, we're going to spend eternity with each other. We better learn to figure it out now, which means we got to be good forgivers. We got to be patient. We got to be kind. We got to be all those things that the Holy Spirit came to produce. Amen? But think about this. The relationships in here, every one of you that knows Christ, we're going to spend eternity together. That's pretty awesome. So we just believe we should start building those relationships now And I don't know if you've been at Living Stones for any length of time, but you'll find that people that are here have really, really powerful, awesome friendships with each other and great relationships. Can I get an amen on that one? And then lastly, kingdom generosity. For God so loved the world that he... One of the most godly things we can do is be generous givers of our time, our lives, our ministry, our money, whatever it is. We want to be generous with our lives. And I don't know, again, if you've experienced that at Living Stones, that's one of our stated values. We just want to be radically generous people. Time, whatever it is, we want to be radically generous. But let's talk about Word and Spirit. We are a church that loves both God's promises and God's presence, all right? I want to cast a little vision with you on this, on how awesome it would be to be a part of a church that wasn't an either-or church, but a both-and church. In other words, we love the Word and we love the Holy Spirit. Not either-or, both, all right? This is said, John chapter 5, verse 35. This was the testimony of John the Baptist. Jesus said this of John, that he was like a burning and shining lamp. How many of you know God's looking for a people, his church, who are going to be people that both burn and shine? When we speak about burning, we're talking about your heart. We're talking about passion. We're talking about zeal. When we talk about shining, we're talking about light. We're talking about truth. We're talking about the Word of God. John the Baptist was a burner and a shiner, all right? Another way we could say we're looking for fire and light. We're looking for hearts and heads. We're looking for the Spirit and truth. We're looking for intimacy and orthodoxy, all right, proper theology. We're looking for passion, and we're looking for precept, all right? We want to love God with our hearts, and we want to love God with our heads. And how many of you know the role of the Holy Spirit is to awaken our hearts with passion for Jesus? Jonathan Edwards, probably what some believe to be the greatest American theologian, and of course, he wrote that incredible book on history of revivals in the church and experienced a great awakening. He said this, that without genuine religious affection in your heart for Jesus, you really have to question whether you've had a born-again experience. Because the Holy Spirit produces new desires and new passions and new fire in your heart for Jesus. In other words, you know, he awakens our hearts that were once dead. And so when you go to a church where the congregation is just dead emotionally, they're just flat, you have to wonder whether they need a fresh move of the Holy Spirit to awaken their hearts so that there's a genuine passion for Jesus. You know, some people say, you know, we love the worship at Living Stones. Can I tell you why, if that's true of you, I'll tell you why that's the case. Because there's passion. Some places sing good theology, praise the Lord for good theology, but there's no passion behind their singing. It's just they've sung that song since they were in third grade. They know the first and the third verse. We always skip the second verse. I don't know why, but they know the first and third verse, and they can sing it by memory. That's great. But is there any fire in your heart? And so we need the Holy Spirit to awaken our hearts to a holy passion for the Son of God. But we also need the Scriptures to bring clarity and truth. Because, listen, if we don't have the Bible, the Jesus that we're worshiping could be a fake. In other words, how do you learn who Jesus even is? From the Bible. How do you learn what Jesus likes? Because you read your Bible. And can I just share with you, one of the problems I think that's happening in America today is people in general will give you a thumbs up for Jesus, but it's a thumbs up without any clarity about who he is, his mission, his calling, his word, his precepts. And so we got a lot of people wearing what would Jesus do bracelets, but they don't have a clue about what Jesus would do because they don't read their Bible. And this is not hard. There are Bible reading plans. I have one on my laptop. There's Bible reading plans that spell it out for you every day. This is what you read. And if you'll read that every day, you'll read through the whole Bible in a year. We should be committed. I'm just throwing this out there. We should be committed as people of God to read through our Bibles every year till Jesus comes. All right? Because when you read the book, you understand who the Holy Spirit is, you understand who the Father is, you understand who the Son is. And let me just say this. All this stuff where the church is going woke, all right, on certain things, usually it's about sexual issues. If you just read your Bible, this isn't complicated. Like, we're not dealing with new perversions that have never been around. No, they're old perversions that are making a comeback. And so when you read the Bible, the Bible talks about every perverted thing that's happening in our culture today because all you've had since the fall are perverts. You know, I shared with you before, okay, we were hypocrites. Somebody actually made me a t-shirt, by the way. Thank you, whoever that mystery person was. They made that t-shirt that says, Living Stones, we're all hypocrites, welcome home, all right? I love it. But I could also say this, Living Stones, we're all perverts, but we've been saved and redeemed and sanctified and cleansed because all of us are broken. Like, perversion is not new to us. It's part of our nature apart from Jesus. Some of you are saying, well, Pastor, I like being a hypocrite better than a pervert. They're basically the same. Don't worry about it. And I don't want to have a t-shirt that says that, so don't get worried. Please do not make that t-shirt, whoever you are. I do not want that t-shirt. But my point is this, so much of the mystery would be removed if we just read the book. So I'm encouraging you, let's read the book because the world is longing for truth and we are. If they don't hear it from the church, where are they going to hear it from? But if we don't read the book, we don't have the clarity, like who is Jesus? What is the Holy Spirit like? You find this out from reading the book, amen? So let's get into the book. The Word and the Spirit always work in harmony to bring about salvation or anything good in our lives. Now, I forget where I learned this the first time, but there's a saying that goes in preaching, after you quote the guy the first time, then you can act like it's yours for every time after that, all right? So I'm going to give you an illustration that's really powerful. It's not mine, but I'll pretend like it's mine. If you've ever been in a hospital and you hear code blue, all right, and the person, what do? They come running in with a defibrillator, all right? Two paddles. If they just put one paddle on, nothing. They put the other paddle on, nothing. They put both paddles on, there's an electric charge that goes shooting through that person's chest, and the goal of all that is to get that heart beating again. Now, all you nurses and doctors can correct it, however I butchered that afterwards, but you all get the point. You got to have both paddles. One of the paddles is the Word. One of the paddles is the Spirit. They have to be used in harmony with each other. When you put them together, it produces a resurrection. It awakens something that was once dead or dying. So you can never separate the Word and the Spirit. We should never try to separate the Word and the Spirit. Now take a look with me in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 5. It says, for when we brought you the good news, it was not only, you should circle that word only because it means not just one or the other. Not only, there's multiple things going on here. Not only with words, but also with power. For the Holy Spirit gave you full assurance that what he said was true. Now, how many know our gospel is words? In other words, there's content to the gospel. That's why we read the book. There's a way to be saved. How many know you got to repent of your sin? You got to turn from your sin. You got to embrace Christ fully in faith. You have to confess with your mouth Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. I mean, how many know the Bible's full? Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. This is all the content of the gospel that's very, very important. But it's not only words. Look at what it says next, but also with power. And this is so important. God's gospel is a gospel of power. And we can never just be satisfied with words only. There should always be a desire in our hearts to experience more of the power of the gospel. Now, this popped into my head first service. I thought it was a good illustration. How many know it's good to read a recipe book? I mean, if you're looking, sometimes my wife should be like, okay, I've got this and this and this. And nowadays with computers, you can put in the ingredients and it spits out recipes for you. It's so cool. You got these three ingredients. What can we make? Here's 15 things, all right? Recipe books are great, but what's the purpose of a recipe book? Well, it's that you act on the recipe, that you make the dish, but we're not done yet. The purpose of the recipe book isn't just that you make the dish, it's that you eat the dish. There are churches that just read the recipe book. They memorize all the recipes. Oh, Jonah, yep, got the recipe. The purpose of the book of Jonah or any other book in the Bible is not so you just memorize the recipe, but that you actually act on the truth and that you taste and see that the Lord is good. That you experience the power of what's in the book. Does this make sense? it would be foolish if we just read from recipe books. I would never want to come to your house. What's for dinner? Well, I'm going to read the recipe from page 365 today, and then we're going to have a word of prayer. That's it? Where's the food? When do I get to eat? And so how many of you know it's not enough just to know the truth? We got to live the truth, and then we got to release the power of the truth, and it all goes together. And then the Bible says, if you're doing this, there is an assurance. I just got to say this. Every single one of us in this room, if I asked you, do you know today, if you were to drop dead right now, that you would stand before the Lord and you have assurance that you're going to spend eternity with him? Every one of us should have the answer to that question. The question is this, though. How do you know? Because you know the word. Because you've experienced the Holy Spirit who ministers to your heart that you are a son or daughter of God. And can I just tell you, knowing that you're saved and having the assurance of your salvation produced by the Word and the Spirit is one of the greatest gifts we could ever have, because it removes from you the fear of death. Amen. It actually removes from you the fear of anything. Yeah. Let's take a look at another passage. Jesus speaking, John 6, 63. The Spirit alone gives eternal life. Human effort accomplishes nothing. Boy, this is a good place to pause. Aren't you glad that the goal of the gospel is to deliver you from religion? That you can get off the religious treadmill. Do more, perform more, study more, memorize more, 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 more. Crack the whip, crack the whip, crack the whip. What a terrible way to live your life. It doesn't mean that we don't care, that we don't live a godly life. It means that that your efforts don't save you. Christ's efforts have saved you. Amen? But look at what it says next. And the very words I have spoken to you are spirit and life. Now, there are people, I've met them, I probably have done it a time or two myself. There are people whose words are correct and true, but the spirit behind them is not the Holy Spirit. I mean, you know, religious people can be some of the nastiest, meanest people you've ever met in your life. I've had people, this sermon is probably for me today to get healed. I could preach 45 minutes on the love of God. And somebody would come up after church and say, well, you know, Pastor, I don't know if I really agree with this point here. And they're just gonna take me to task on it. And I said to a person one time, I said, you know, I just preached for 45 minutes on the love of God. Is there nothing you heard that was slightly edifying? What is it in you that has to attack and has to find fault? What is that in you? Because you might be accurate, but your spirit's not right. Or I'm going to bring it down to a very non-spiritual but very spiritual arena. How about raising our kids? Have you ever told your kids the truth? Well, let me just tell you what's going to happen if you do that again. It's not going to end very well. I mean, there's times you tell your kids, what you say is true, but the way that you said it didn't minister life, it ministered death. Or let's bring it home again. How about in your marriage? I can tell my wife the truth, and I might pay for it for a decade. That's the truth. Because it's not about being right as much as it's having the right spirit. People can receive just about anything with the right spirit behind it. So if people know that you love them and smile when you talk to them, and you know that they know that they're committed to your success, they are much easier going to hear what you have to say and be able to hear the truth. So notice Jesus' words are always spirit and their life. In other words, he speaks truth. It hits you with the power of the Holy Spirit, and the result of it is people get resurrected to life. How many of you want to live like that? Amen? Spirit, truth, hand in glove. Let me give you one other verse, probably one of the best passages to highlight this, John chapter 4, verse 23. The time is coming, indeed it is here now, when true worshipers, everybody say true worshipers, will worship the Father, notice this, in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship him that way. How many know? So we want to be a church that loves the Word of God and loves the presence of the Holy Spirit. Are y'all with me? You tracking with me, or do you need me to lay hands on you right now for the Holy Ghost to awaken you? All right? The Word of God, the Spirit of God, and I want you to see how these work together. It's beautiful. How many have heard the phrase zeal without knowledge? In other words, people can be passionate but ignorant. Jonathan Edwards also said this. I've never forgotten it. He said, if you want passion in your heart, fill your mind with light and truth. If you want your mind full of light and truth, fill your heart with passion. Because how many of you know if you had an encounter with Christ and he changed you, you want to know more about him. No one has to force you to read the Bible. You want to read your Bible because your heart is full of passion for God. But how about this? When you read your Bible, the Holy Spirit starts showing you things that are amazing, and it causes your heart to come alive with fire for Jesus. But you can't have more fire than you have light, and you can't have more light than you have fire. They work together all the time. See how this works? All right, let me move on. Let's talk about a demonic divorce that has happened in the church, all right? The Bible says in Mark chapter 10, let no one split apart what God has joined together. What I'm trying to say today is God has forever wedded the Word and the Spirit in his church, all right? And I would say this, don't let the devil split apart what God has forever united. Now, most of us have come from somewhere, right? You have a church history. And even though most churches would agree with this in principle, how many know this is one of the most contentious areas in the typical church is the Word versus the Spirit. And usually they're at war with each other. Let me give you an example, all right? Some of you came from churches that were known for strong Bible teaching. There were Bible studies all week long, Bible studies about everything, and there's no problem with that. I'm not minimizing that, but they would be known as a Word church. Many times in that culture, sometimes relational connections are not so strong. Sometimes the worship's not as strong or dynamic. Certainly, there's very little room many times for the Holy Spirit, but we're going to teach the Bible, all right? Other times, you come from churches that are alive and on fire, but weak in terms of teaching the Scripture. In other words, the worship is dynamic, man. People are, woo! But when it comes to the Word, not so much. Wouldn't it be great if we focused not on either or, but on both, all right? And so take a look here at the ministry of Jesus. I want to make a point that one without the other is simply incomplete. Look at what it says about Jesus' ministry in Luke 24. He was a prophet who did powerful miracles, and he was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all the people. So first of all, we see Jesus as a mighty teacher. He was a word man, all right? A word man more than any other man, all right? He was a man of the Word. He knew the Word. He was a prophet. What do prophets do? They say, thus saith the Lord. Jesus was the prophet, all right? He spoke the Word of the Lord. But I want you to see what happened next. It says, not only was he a prophet, but he did powerful miracles. So here's the point of Jesus' life. He didn't just talk about it or know it. He released the presence of God and the power of the Holy Spirit through his life. Now, how many know Jesus is our example in all things? Let me try that again. Jesus is our example in all things. So I'm trying to connect the dots here. So we need to be word people. Every one of you know, the writer of Hebrews challenged the church that they should have been farther along and they should have been teaching and ministering and helping other people when they were still, he had to give them baby food. So, I mean, you know, we got to grow up. Every one of us in this room should be at some point in your life equipped to teach at some level, all right? Which I just want to say this. The most forgiving audience is children's ministry. I know people who, when they're baby Christians, they want to serve in some way. Well, you know what? You got a lesson that's written for a kindergartner, and you know how to read. And while you teach the lesson to the kindergartners, you're learning basic truths about the Bible. So we can all be teaching and ministering at some level, and we should all have that as a goal. But how many of you know, too, you also want to carry with you the presence of God so that when you pray for people and minister to people, you're ministering to them in the power of the Holy Spirit, because the Word without the Spirit is incomplete, and the Spirit without the Word is incomplete. You got to have both to bring resurrection power and to bring an impact in people's lives. All right, let's take a look at what Jesus said to the Sadducees. Matthew chapter 22, verse 29. Jesus said, hey guys, here's your mistake. Number one, you don't know the Bible. You don't know the scriptures. And number two, you don't know the power of God. So how many know that's two strikes? They're out, all right? You don't get three strikes. He said, number one, you pride yourself in the knowledge of God, but you don't know the scriptures. The Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection from the dead, which kind of has a problem with Jesus, right, and his resurrection. So he says, you don't know the Bible, and then you've never experienced personally, you've never tasted of the presence and power of Jesus. So Jesus condemned them for that, all right, gives a strong word. So here's what I want to do. I want to have a little bit of fun with you in the time that we have left, all right? I want you to picture a marriage between the Bible and the Holy Spirit, all right? The Word and the Spirit. We're going to call the groom Bible man. We're going to call the wife Spirit woman. Now, I don't want anybody to get offended. This is not gender specific. I'm not trying to pigeonhole or categorize women one way and men another way. You can have female Bible woman, and you could have male Spirit man, all right? That's my point. But we're going to just call him, for the sake of this illustration, we're going to call him Bible man, all right? Let me describe Bible man to you. Now, again, if some of this gets a little close to home, just laugh, because we're all going to land on either one side of the continuum or the other, and I'm pushing these to ridiculous extremes to make a point, all right? So just laugh with me. Don't anybody get offended, and don't anybody come up here and lecture me after I say amen. All right. Bible man, this believer has knowledge without intimacy. How many of you know you can grow in your knowledge of God, but not grow more close with Jesus in your walk with Jesus? Some people are like factoid experts on the Bible. They win Bible quiz bowls like the Pharisees. But if the Messiah stood in front of them, they would not know him, because they just know a lot of facts. They have knowledge without intimacy. They have propositional truth, but no personal relationship. They're intellectually knowing God, but not experientially. Now, can I just say something? We need to watch being preachy with other people in areas where we have zero experience personally. Like, I don't want to come up and preach to you about something that I'm not living in my own life. Because if I'm preaching about something I've not tasted personally, then there's no anointing on what I'm preaching. Does this make sense? So you don't want to just have a head knowledge without an experiential knowledge. And I want to make another point here. The Bible man equates spiritual growth with more Bible knowledge. Have you ever seen people like that? Oh, I want to get closer to Jesus. I'm gonna go to another Bible study. Have we all figured out that actually reading your Bible more does not equate with greater intimacy with Jesus? Have any of you been living, don't have to raise your hand, but have any of you been living in open sin in your life? Like, this is wrong, but you have a quiet time every morning because you're religious. And you think that if you have your quiet time, it will somehow erase the fact that you're still living in open sin against God. So reading your Bible more does not mean you're growing more spiritually. Actually, reading your Bible and obeying what it teaches is the key to growing spiritually. Remember when Willow Creek did their, appreciate the fact that they were honest. They had their big spiritual development model, and basically it was taking people from this class to this class to this class to this class to this class, and then producing a fully mature, obedient follower of Jesus Christ. Well, what they actually found was when they surveyed everybody to see how fully obedient disciples of Christ they were, they found that that model didn't work at all. Because going to 5-10-week classes does not mean you're going to change at all. It just means you're going to classes because you like to learn things and because you think if you go to classes, you'll be a better Christian. That's not how it works. I could read 100 books on marriage and still be mean as a rattlesnake to my wife, and she could care less that I told her I picked up another book. Hey, hon, got another book on marriage. Because what she would be saying is, When are you going to practice it? And when is the transformation in you going to actually touch my heart and cause our relationship to go to another level? So my point is, reading books, including the Bible, by itself does not equate spiritual maturity. Okay, Bible man, this is a good one. Bible man believes that the Bible is the only way God speaks today. If you want to hear God's voice, read the book. Well, you just left out the whole ministry of the Holy Spirit. Because yes, we should read the book. Read the book. I heard. Hope you hear me say that 1,000 times. Read the book. But what good does it do you to read a book without the author? Read the book with the author and listen to what the author is saying about the book. Otherwise, you're just going, again, through dry religious ritual. The Holy Spirit wants to take those words and make them alive to you. Amen. This is why, again, you can't hand an unbeliever the Bible and just expect because they read through the Gospel of John, they're going to get saved. If the Holy Spirit doesn't show up, they might as well read the phone book. Because spiritual things are spiritually discerned. You don't read the Bible like a science book. You have to have the Holy Spirit encountering you and opening your eyes and teaching you the Word of God. But Bible man thinks that if he just sits down with his Bible, that's all that he needs. He emphasizes Bible knowledge over experience. Knowing the Bible is more important than experiencing the truth of the Bible. He feels, how about this one, guys? He feels more comfortable listening to the sermon than actually participating in praise and worship. There used to be a guy that came to our church intentionally late every week. He conveniently arrived right after worship because we don't need to be doing all that worship stuff, that feely stuff. Just preach the word. I don't know about you, but I found that the worship stuff gets my heart in a whole lot better situation to actually hear the word and apply the word than if I just come to listen to a message. Amen. Or there are people who come just for the worship and then they don't have an appetite for the word. Those we're going to talk about spirit woman in just a minute. But my point is this. I mean, no, you need both. Or I've had people. Okay. I've had people come in. They sit down. And if any of you do this, I have no knowledge of you right now. Don't you dare judge me for this. I'm just sharing. I've seen people, they come into church, they sit down before service, they open up their Bible, and they do this. Now, Pastor, is there something the matter with reading your Bible in church? Of course not. But my point is, why are you doing that now when all of God's people are coming into church and you're sitting at your seat staring at your Bible? It seems like you might be hiding in your Bible instead of trying to have a deep encounter with Jesus, because the people that you're supposed to be encountering are all around you, but you're not even looking at them. I know I'm kicking some sacred cows this morning, but this is the truth. I used to harp on our worship team. Hey, people, awesome people. When you sing, don't just start the music and everybody start singing. Like, there's people out here. Talk to them. Hey, church, y'all ready to worship? We sang 5 songs, and then we stopped. We didn't talk at the beginning. We didn't talk in the middle. We didn't talk at the end. What was that? I don't know. But why don't you act like there's people here? Now, how many of you know our team's been cured of that? All right? They talk to you now. My point is this. The gospel is about relationship and not just about head knowledge or ideas or singing the right song or quoting the right verse. There's people here that Jesus died for, and you have to have the relationship and the heart involved or you miss out on the very people that Jesus created and gave his life for to save. You with me? Does that make sense? All right. This person gets irritated because the singing is too long. We should be placing the emphasis on the Word of God. The verse on Bible man's refrigerator, 1 Corinthians 14:40. Let all things be done decently and in order. I just want to remind you that that has to be seen contextually, because everywhere Jesus went, there was chaos. Not because of heresy, but because of the power of the Holy Spirit. Do you realize the Holy Spirit is messy? Do you realize when God touches people, you can't control their response, nor should you try? I've been at an altar before where we're praying for people to experience the love of God, and where one person is weeping uncontrollably, and the person next to them is laughing uncontrollably. That doesn't seem like decently and in order. We should have a program. You're either a laugher or you're a crier, but we're not doing this at the same time. Well, that's not how the Holy Spirit works. If you want decent and in order, go to the graveyard. Everything is in perfect order, and it's manicured. There's flowers out there, but you won't find any life. Wherever there's life, there's disorder. So I'm just saying that verse is a great verse. Don't put your template of control on the Holy Spirit, because when the Holy Spirit's moving, things get really awesomely exciting and unpredictable. But Bible man people don't like that, or Bible woman people, because they just want it all on the page. They want their bulletin with footnotes. All right? And it just doesn't work that way. All right, I beat up on Bible man long enough. Let's go to Spirit woman. Spirit woman loves intimacy without knowledge. She emphasizes experience over the scriptures. And in fact, she really doesn't like to read or study very much. In fact, let me just say this. She avoids systematic approaches to anything, seeing them as responsible for quenching the Holy Spirit. Now, I love the prophetic. We believe in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And many times when you're sensing what God's saying, it's in the moment. It's not in a program. It's very spontaneous. That's the nature of the Holy Spirit, right? How many of you know when you're out and about and you're ministering, the Holy Spirit puts on your heart, go pick up that person. Go witness to that person. Go give that person money. That wasn't what you had on your to-do list, was it? So you just have to go with him. You have to obey him. But let me just say this. We should not have to have a word from the Holy Spirit to have systematic Bible study going on in our life. Like, I don't need an angelic visitation to tell me that I need to be reading my Bible every day. And can I just say this? Systematic does not mean quenching the Holy Spirit. How many of you know a river has two banks and then it has a whole bunch of water moving through it? I found this to be the case in the church. The banks are the doctrine. It's the truth. It's the word. The river is the Holy Spirit. Some churches have incredible banks. There's just no water. Some churches have incredible water. There's no banks. And I want to remind you that a river without banks is a swamp. Now, I know we got some Cajuns in here. My son-in-law is one of them. He's a Cajun. Even Cajuns don't go play in the swamp. At least I think not. There's snakes in there. There's spiders in there. There's critters in there. You're not going to run around barefooted through a swamp. You're going to try to stay away from it. At least I'm staying away from the swamp. But we all enjoy a beautiful river, do we not? My point is this. You got to have the banks, and you got to have the river. You got to have the word, and you got to have the spirit, and they have to go together. All right. Here's the verse on Spirit Woman's refrigerator, 1 John chapter 2, verse 20. But you have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. Selah. There's nothing worse than a person who loves the Holy Spirit but has no value for the local church, for the Word of God, or for the authority in the local church. And many times we'd have people that would have a word from God, but they wouldn't submit the word from God. Or if the leadership didn't act on that immediately, then we were quenching the Holy Spirit, and they're out the door. That's imbalance, all right? You have to trust that the Spirit of God moving in you is the same Holy Spirit that's moving in the rest of your church and in the leadership of your church. And you have to value what's happening here. You have to value the team, all right? You have to value the team. And many times folks that feel like they've got a bat. Y'all remember the bat phone, the big red phone they can call Batman with. Some Christians think they got a bat phone to heaven, and they don't have to ask anybody, be submit to anybody, learn from anybody. They have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit told me. Watch that kind of attitude, too, because whatever the Holy Spirit told you, you should find confirmation amongst God's people and amongst the leadership God's put in your life for your blessing. So, yes, please listen to the Holy Spirit. We should be listening to the Holy Spirit. But it should never be an exclusion to the Word or everything the Word teaches about the church and the church family. All right? So let's talk about why we need to be committed to this marriage. And I'm going to close with this. Why we need to be committed to this marriage. How many know because Jesus Christ is the prize that we're after? And I ask this question. How do you know Jesus? Well, you know Jesus through the Scriptures. Well, how do you come to love Jesus? Well, you come to love Jesus when the Holy Spirit moves the truth in your head to the fire in your heart, and you have a passion for Jesus Christ. Now, I want my wife to come up here and join me as we wrap this up this morning. Give her a hand. What a beauty. The Bible says in Romans chapter 5, verse 5, "For we know how dearly God loves us because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love." How many of you know you can tell somebody God loves you? And they can go, okay. But when you tell somebody God loves them and there's the anointing of the Holy Spirit that's present, they get rocked by the love of God. Because the Holy Spirit, the Bible says, fills their hearts with God's love. We need the Holy Spirit to experience the goodness of God, to experience the love of God. The Scriptures make Christ clear, but the Holy Spirit makes Christ dear. The Word makes Jesus plain, but the Holy Spirit makes Jesus precious. You understand the need for both. And lovers have many ways of expressing their love, but especially two. And number one, in words. So I tell my wife, I love you.
Love you too.
Thanks. But the other way we express our love is through the kiss. Now, let me just tell you, I'm not trying to get, some of you are going, oh, gross, I saw some, okay. No, this is a good illustration. Yeah. All right, this is, I don't want you ever to miss it. Why are we committed to this marriage between Word and Spirit? Because if I tell my wife all day long, oh, I love you, I love you, I love you, but my actions don't prove it, and all it is words, there's going to be a hollowness to what I'm saying. And so the kiss connects the words with the heart. But you know what? I can try kissing her and chasing her around the kitchen all day long like some of you guys. I know you need to come up here for prayer, right? I could be Mr. Kiss Monster all day long, but you know what? If there's no structure behind our relationship in terms of the content of our relationship, my words to her, if there's no meaning to those words, then the honeymoon's over in a hurry. But when your word and your spirit, now you got something cooking, all right? It's the same thing. Why is it? Here's the way I like to look at it. We come in to worship, and we sing and we worship first. What are we doing? We're starting off smooching first. Because is not worship the releasing of our affections to Jesus? And we're just saying, we love you, we honor you, we worship you. And then what do? We sit under the Word of God because the Word of God provides the clarity as to how I love my wife and what love looks like. So you got to know what love looks like, how you act, what you say, what you don't say. And then you have to act on that profession, which is the smooch. Now, I'm demonstrating self-control right now because I could illustrate this over and over again to you guys, but I'm not going to do that. Let me close with this. The Bible says the word without, not the Bible, this is a quote. The word without the Spirit makes us dry up. How many of you can relate to that? The Spirit without the Word makes us blow up. But the Spirit with the Word makes us grow up. That's what we're after. Amen? So can we pursue both of these as a church at Living Stones? You say, well, what's Living Stones like? You guys love the Word? Yes. Are you guys a Word church? Yes, we are. Are you guys a Bible-believing church? Yes. Do you guys celebrate the Word? Yes, 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 yes. Well, what else are you? Well, we're also a Holy Spirit church. We love the Spirit. We love the presence. We love Jesus with all of our heart. We love worshiping Him, and we love loving one another and loving the world that Jesus died for. We're a Word church, and we're a Spirit church. And when you put those together, I'm telling you, you got an explosive environment for God to work in. Stand to your feet. We want to pray with you this morning. This would be an appropriate time for every married man to tell his wife how much he loves her and give her a little kiss on the cheek, but that is appropriate in church, you know. Let's pray. Father, thanks for these amazing people, and thank you for the culture that you're building here, God. We just want to be alive with the Spirit, and we want to be so grounded and on fire with the truth of your Word. Lord, marry those two things here. Thank you for all that you're doing. Thank you, Lord, for the 50 or so folks that are going to obey you publicly by identifying with you in water baptism. We thank you for all that you're doing in life groups and all the different ministries, the transformation that's happening in our lives. Lord, it's because of your Word and your Spirit. So Jesus, may you find in Living Stones a place where those two are forever happily married. We just pray this all in your mighty name, and everybody said, amen. Hey, have a great day. We'll see you all a little bit later. Don't forget, you come back if you got time for the baptisms. If you're new, we want to meet you. Come on down. If you need prayer, come on down.
And you'll be here.